Hey folks, welcome to Real Thursdays. I'm Michael Phillips of the Chicago Tribune, and we are going to be talking about World War Z, the zombie film with Brad Pitt, opening tonight, Thursday night at 8 p.m. Also, Monsters University, the new Pixar film, the sequel to Monsters, Inc. And sadly, we have another segment we're going to be sharing with you, in that it's a tribute to the late James Gandolfini, best known for his role, amazingly, beautifully cast role as Tony Soprano in The Sopranos. Gandolfini died yesterday in Rome on vacation of an apparent heart attack at the age of 51. We'll talk about his work on The Sopranos and also his somewhat underrated screen career as well. But first, like it or not, zombies. Chris Borelli. I'm here with Chris Borelli, my colleague here at the Tribune. You've got a zombie story running as well.
About an old, sort of a not a very original story, but a fun story about fast versus slow zombies and the eternal debate, as somebody calls it. Yeah.
Okay. Now, World War Z, very fast zombies.
Very fast. What's interesting is that they're faster than the fast zombies. The fast zombies previously were the fast zombies in 28 Days Later, Zombieland, that kind of thing. Now they kind of move like a, almost like running water, like a stream, like just effortlessly. They're so fast. Yeah. It's a.
They're elegant. They're athletes.
They're elegant zombies. They're yes.
They're agile.
They're very agile.
Okay. Yeah. Great. So let's set up the premise.
Yeah, sorry.
This is based on Max Brooks's a novel,
right?
And we just have sort of this worldwide, amazingly sudden zombie epidemic, and they never really get to the source of this in a way.
Not in the book either.
Right, the book, which is very different from the movie. The script for the film creates this role for Brad Pitt as a UN investigator who's fleeing his home in Philadelphia with his wife and two daughters. And actually, we'll take a look at this scene that comes rather early in World War Z, and actually I think it's one of the best scenes in the film, in that it's the first zombie attack. We don't have any idea yet what's actually happening. This is all in the first 10-15 minutes of the picture, and they're essentially caught in traffic and
in Philadelphia, downtown Philadelphia.
City of brotherly hate in this case, but anyway, we'll take a look at this and then discuss World War Z.
Does it live in the jungle?
Oh. No.
Is it an animal you'd have for a pet?
Yes.
Is it a cat?
Yes.
Ha ha ha. You totally got one.
Why are there so many? It's like three in the last 5 minutes.
What is going on?
Hey.
Yo.
He's just going to keep going, Daddy?
Hold on, guys.
Daddy, be careful on the road.
It's okay, baby.
This film, it goes all over the place. In no time, you have Pitt's family evacuated out of Newark. In this case, they drive from Philly to Newark. Mm-hmm. They escape this zombie melee in Newark. They're offshore on the Atlantic on an aircraft carrier. He's dispatched Pitt and some various military personnel.
Korea.
Dispatched to Korea. Then he goes to Jerusalem. We're all over the place in this picture, and yet I think actually, because it's kind of a hectic film that goes all over the place, I think again, one of the more effective scenes is is a plane that's going from Jerusalem to Cardiff, Wales, and on board you have a lot of apparently very healthy survivors, and then you do have one zombie hiding out in coach.
In the lavatory.
In coach.
Right.
Yeah, and
right.
So
of course.
There's kind of a great moment in this scene where you hear this sort of ruckus going on, and all the people in first class kind of pull the curtain open. It's like, what's going on in coach? But in fact, it's a zombie film. But I like that scene. I like some of the big scenes. But I gotta say, man, this thing, at least half of it, is a complete mess. I mean, they evidently, and there's a lot written about World War Z's production trouble, but they threw out the last third of the film after
Moscow, I think.
Yes,
right?
There was a huge zombie battle in Moscow, and they threw it all out and just said, look, let's just go a whole different route, and to actually rewrite
and then reshoot at that stage of a production of a movie that may have cost north of $200 million, that's unusual.
In the final scene, too, it's kind of interesting. Knowing the production history, when they actually get to that final scene that you know they shot late, it's kind of a small scene that could probably pop up in any indie film, you know?
This is all set in the World Health Organization laboratory, right?
Oh, you mean the right, exactly. Yeah, well, sure, to some extent. And then the final scene where he's reunited with his family, which I guess it's not to be a spoiler. I don't think it's a spoiler, really. It's been kind of heavily reported.
No, we can't say if he lives or dies. So
we can't see if he lives or dies.
That was a spoiler. Yeah.
It was, okay. Yeah, okay.
So he may have lived, he may die.
You know, I think the problem with this movie to some extent is, well, number one, the director is, he just cannot juggle this kind of stuff. He's terrible with action, aside from that plane scene, which I really like.
Yeah, we should say it's Mark Forster.
Who
made the second to last Bond film, Quantum of Solace.
Which almost killed the Bond series again.
Quantum of Solace, which everybody turned out for anyway, but that really was the weakest and kind of the most poorly staged action.
Because you never know what's going on. You never know what's going on. And I think in that, even in that Philadelphia scene at the beginning, as well as he sets it up, you don't really know what's going on for a little bit. But not in a, I don't know, I'm not sure it's that effective. Like, it's too hard to get a feel of anything concrete in the scene. Like, you never focused on anything.
Right.
And I don't know, I think in general, I think the biggest problem with this movie is that it doesn't, it's probably trying to stay a little bit close to the book.
Next, we're going to talk about Monsters University, the new Pixar picture, which is a sequel to the 2001 Monsters, Inc., a big success. And I'm here with Genevieve Koski from thedissolve.com. How you doing?
Good, how are you?
And you were with, you're the senior editor of this new venture, and this is all the Onion AV Club folk gathering together under the Pitchfork Media banner, right?
Yes.
Okay, good. Well, good luck on the launch.
Yeah, we're launching soon.
Okay, good. So, Monsters University. This is a film that reunites the characters voiced by Billy Crystal and John Goodman, Mike and Sully, and it's a prequel, in fact, in that you're taking these characters back to where they meet in college at the Scarers College of Choice, Monsters U, and you're going through various initiation rites and hazing, and it's a really more frightening image of college life, I think, than even the musical Wicked, or probably any of the Revenge of the Nerds pictures. But before we talk about what we think of this thing, let's show this scene that is, in fact, the first initiation that Mike and Sully have to endure.
Hello? Fellas?
Do you pledge your souls to the Uzma Kappa Brotherhood?
Do you swear to keep secret
all that you learn here?
No matter how horrifying!
Will you take the sacred oath of the...
They're crying out loud.
Sweetie, turn the lights on while you're down here. You're going to ruin your eyes.
Mom, we're doing an initiation.
Oh, scary. Well, carry on. Just pretend I'm not here.
This is my mom's house. Do you promise to look out for your brothers? No matter what the peril, will you defend Uzma Kappa, no matter how dangerous, no matter how insurmountable the odds may be, from evils both great and small, in the face of unending pain and... Oh, forget it! You're in!
Genevieve, that's almost funny, I think. But what did you think of this film?
I liked it quite a bit. That's maybe not the standout scene, but I think on the spectrum of Pixar sequels/prequels, it kind of falls right in between the excellent Toy Story sequels and the maybe less than excellent Cars sequel. But I think it's just as entertaining as Monsters, Inc. It's even better looking, but it doesn't quite reach the same level of, like, Pixar-ness.
Heartwarming. Maybe I'm up against my own high standards with Pixar, but I really didn't have a very good time with this film. I did not. I found the really kind of heavy and charmless, and sort of the humor was much more in the vein for me of, like, kind of a DreamWorks sequel, you know, where, you know, it was just a lot of snark and insults and dread.
The first two acts, I tend to agree with you on that. It definitely doesn't really kick in and become the movie that it really feels like it's supposed to be until the third act, once they get away from kind of the standard campus comedy slash underdog sports format they're going with, which has a lot of kind of expected beats. And but then once the scare games that the Uzma Kappa fraternity is competing in are over, I think it goes in a much more interesting direction that kind of gets at the heart of what the relationship between Mike and Sully becomes.
That's a good point. In fact, when you actually break it down, and I didn't realize this, I think until just now, almost half of the movie is taken up with these scare games, which is basically kind of like a slightly less sinister version of the Hunger Games trials that they have to, you know, kind of compete in.
Yeah.
It looks good. I wouldn't really argue with much of the execution, but to me, where is the wit in the script? That's my question.
Yeah. I think Mike is, in general, a little bit of a less lovable character, the character voiced by Billy Crystal. Or he's maybe just a little harder to love, although Sully actually is quite a bit of a bore.
That's the whole thing. He's basically kind of a boorish, insecure, overbearing guy.
I was actually thinking about this while watching it. They're kind of in a Buzz and Woody relationship for a lot of the movie. Like, you know, enemies who we know eventually become friends, but I think it's undercut a little by the fact that we've seen what their partnership becomes, so we kind of know where it's heading.
Right.
So the rivalry between them is a little expected, but it's nice to see the progression of Mike's character into him discovering what he's actually good at and the role that he eventually fills in their friendship.
Right. I just think that right now what they need to do is turn out a better sequel than either Cars 2 or Monsters University.
Or something that's not a sequel.
Yes. Even better.
Prequel.
Even better. So now let's talk about, Chris, we'll all talk about, unfortunately, James Gandolfini, who died yesterday in Rome on vacation at the age of 51. The actor was best known for his role, his iconic role, which is a word everyone's throwing around this week, right or wrong, as the mob boss, the Capo of New Jersey, Tony Soprano in The Sopranos, David Chase's groundbreaking HBO series. And Chris, I think the question I have, the first thing I did when I heard that he died is I took a look at the series finale, which is that 4-minute scene in the diner. I actually watched it with the sound off just to see what Gandolfini does with these sort of micro gestures and these fleeting sort of expressions on his face. Does so much without even talking. And he, has there ever been a more magically well-cast major TV role ever?
No, and you know, it's amazing. That's a great example, because that scene, which was incredibly controversial, right? The very, very final scene of the film, which just kind of cuts to black.
Of the series,
Of the series, when it cuts to black, a lot of people didn't like it, but you know, what you're describing in him is it completely encapsulates that character that he, he was the show for a lot of people, and well, he was the show really, but it encapsulates that character in the sense that this is a guy in purgatory permanently. He's permanently in purgatory. He has been for the 10 years the show ran, or 8 years, and it ends with him kind of stuck in purgatory. I mean, we don't really know what happens to him, but I don't want to discuss the end here, but
no,
that's a long time ago. But you know what I'm saying?
It's amazing, like, performance.
Yeah, it sums up, I think, everything that he did right with that series, which was portray this guy who is sort of self-aware but not really self-aware. He's not a very ironic guy. I said this to you earlier, but to me, he's very specific. When I heard he died, it was very specific. I had a very specific reaction. I'm from the East Coast. I'm from that area. I grew up with people exactly like him. He represented kind of an average Italian on screen, on TV. And I've never seen anybody that really got it as well as he did.
Mm. You're a fan of Not Fade Away, among other things. Genevieve, you told me something sort of surprising, that one of your favorite Gandolfini performances on screen was...
Actually, Where the Wild Things Are, where he was the voice of Carol. And I just, you know, when you mentioned David Chase, I was reading a statement from him about Gandolfini's passing, and he mentioned the sadness in Gandolfini's eyes that he saw, and I think that kind of speaks to the humanity and the kind of strain of melancholy that he brought to Tony Soprano, but to a lot of his characters. And, you know, you think a big fuzzy monster is, you know, quite far removed from Tony Soprano, but I think the Carol character kind of was a great showcase for how he could be like really volatile, but also really warm and vulnerable. And it's interesting because it's just his voice,
right,
you know.
Right.
Because he's associated with such an iconic character, you know, whenever Gandolfini popped up in a film post Sopranos, there was always an element of there's Tony Soprano.
There he is again. Well, maybe now the time is to rediscover the films that didn't get the audience the first
time. Watch Sopranos again. I mean, really, it holds up. So, you know, I'll say this. When I heard he died, I went to like a lot of people, I think, I probably went to YouTube and looked up clips and stuff. There was a scene where he talks about, we're the strong silent types. There's no more strong silent types anymore. We're the Gary Coopers out there. And then he ends that with saying, the problem with the strong silent types is once you start to let them talk, they couldn't shut them up anymore. And like, to me, that's like, that kind of encapsulates his character too, in
a
way.
Yeah,
you know?
That's right. No, that's good. Yeah. Well, it's a good time to look back at the work and mourn the loss of the actor James Coburn. Chris Brelli, thank you very much.
Thanks.
Jenna Minkowski, thank you very much. And we'll see you next Thursday for Real Thursdays. I'm Michael Phillips.